Okay, how do you feel it? Let's start.
Yes.
That's gonna be a long section, so sorry for that, but I was a little bit thinking, especially this morning when I just woke up, my left eye started to burn. So I just feel that, David, you are ready for the presentation, fire and explosion control. So I'm so sorry, I'm not blind, but I try to be focused on this topic. However, I would like to say thank you for the invitation, since this is the group level event, and me from the ENP, Exploration and Production, can be here together with you, maybe to learn something from you. I really hope that, since I'm sitting with expert, agency expert, I'm not aware of all of the topic in detail, but maybe some of you are. Let's see. At the end of this day, we will see it. How does it work for us? I always like to use some cases which will just teach us. Right now I just, how to say, touch the very relevant and very well-known cases. Who is that person here in the room who never ever heard about Piper Alpha? Please just raise your hands. Everyone, it's clear. Clear for everyone. That's why we don't start at the very beginning from the video. Otherwise, it's going to be too long. Later on, I would suggest everyone that go home, use the YouTube. You can at home. me can manage it from here otherwise. So thanks for more. It takes for a week to convince the IT security that I need it. But I never ever use it. I just download at home, figure it out somehow. So, go ahead. Sorry. I'm not loud enough. So right now I would like to, ooh, sorry, I don't want to touch it. Layer of protection, one, I don't know how does it called, but something like this. This one. So right now we will watch the video. Approximately, it's a second part of it. It takes approximately 20 minutes. Like you did at the very beginning, be very careful what we watch. This is the movie for everyone otherwise, from National Geographic, just how to say, admire the people that, hey, that's happened. But like, we are an expert, we have to see in a detail. Not all of the detail can be seen from this video, but I try to share with you later on, since I'm just look over or look after some other very nice and good presentation, which is still on YouTube, so you can check me later on this afternoon, late afternoon. Please, try to focus on the protection layers. Where we are right now. Not all of them will be, how to say, directly touch our topic or presentation, but like we are agency people, we can just have to know what kind of other protection layer existing or could existing and try to define. That's why I will share with you a paper. I hope it's here, yes. Or please just share it. Very difficult, I just prepared. But over the sharing period, I would like to ask you, everyone could see it, this is from the upstream facility, not downstream, sorry for that, but later on we will find the connections. At the very beginning, like a very good agency expert, please start to think and tell me what is the main difference from emergency point of view between this kind of offshore platform and any other onshore facility. If you have any guess, just please tell me. Someone?
Evacuation.
Very good. At the first, what's the main difference between the evacuation? Between the offshore and offshore? Off and on, sorry. What do you think?
Onshore is it's easier.
Much easier. Has to be very organized at the very beginning on onshore, in case of the FCC unit, for instance. Has to be. Could say yes. But if I would be there and see an explosion or fire, and if I'm smart, run away immediately. Without any just waiting for someone that please tell me that can I run away or not, or just wait here. Of course, we have assembly point, etc. issues, which is just very important. But trust me, in this case, you will forget where it is. Just go away. Yeah. This is the, could say, first one. What else can be?
Waiting for help.
Yeah, additional resources, like firefighters, so it's much easier to get them onshore than...
Yeah, it could be second one. On this kind of offshore facilities, do we have real fire brigade, like FAIR, or how do you call it in Ina, the fire brigade?
Sinaco.
Okay. So no Sinaco people. Of course, that is the built-in fire protection. If it's work or not, let's see. But you have to only trust this one. But you cannot wait for the strong and quick mans who will save you. Exactly. That's the second different. What is the, could say the first, but this is the one. What can be the main difference still? Just think. What are you doing afternoon? After 3 o'clock, 3:30. Go home. Here?
Stay there, show up to different.
Stay there and go up to the up and enjoy. Yes. And happen over the night, what can happen? This is a disaster, something like that, the Titanic. On the sea, lot of people in there. Everyone is happy. Could say that. Just stay relaxed. And over the night, something happened. You're just surprised what's going to happen. So this is the main three differences, what we have to handle somehow later on. But of course, our presentation, not touch this one, but we are agency people and we have to know this. But it's very important, since this case teaches us that on the onshore, we have to think as well, maybe not that kind of structured way, but we have to. Which is just, from this point of view, looks easier than this one. Let's start. Sometimes I will stop the video and just put a little bit further. It's going to be altogether, as I mentioned you, approximately 20 minutes. And later on, we will raise our question. Please just use your paper, make notes. What kind of notes we need? I have one. Identify the existing protection layer, which we can just see. Any. Doesn't matter if it's worked or not. Later on, try to identify those existing protection layers which was not in function or not able to work. How did we call it yesterday? That was the special word for it in a tripod.
Barriers?
Something like that, which is just existing but not working. Barriers. Okay. Later on, that's going to be an exercise for us that figure out, since this event, 1988, someone could say that, oh, come on, it's 25 years. I don't know how many years. I'm not good in mathematics, 27 already. Earlier just happened. So it cannot happen with us again. It can. Otherwise, who was here yesterday morning, Donna presentation? One picture was showed from last year, nearly the same platform. Alex and me just, were confused, since we believe that it's Piper Alpha. It wasn't. 1 year before, it just got fired. Three people died at the time. Okay, too much talking. Let's see. I hope the voice will be okay in just a minute. Good.
To keep the massive rig running smoothly, the complex machinery requires regular servicing. It's a never-ending job. 7:45 a.m. Lead production operator Bernard Curtis issues permits for the day's maintenance work. They strictly enforce the rule that no one can work on the platform without one. It's just one of many systems in place to ensure safety on the massive rig. With 226 men living and working so close to such volatile fuel, it's vital. Piper Alpha has been in service for 12 years. Its main job is processing oil. This happens on the production deck. It's made of four modules. Module D contains power generation. Module C and B process oil and gas. In module A, oil is piped up from below the sea floor. Sitting on top of all this is a self-contained city with living quarters and entertainments for the small army of workers for whom Piper Alpha is a home away from home. It all happens 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. 12 p.m. On the production deck, two maintenance workers are removing a safety valve. It's a routine job authorized that morning. They're due to finish by the end of the shift at 6 p.m. For control room operator Jeff Bollins, it's just another regular day.
There's men doing maintenance, the oil wells were filling oil, the machines were running, compressing gas. It was a private activity.
5:10 p.m. Jeff Bollins begins his final shift in the control room before leaving the rig.
It was a good shift because we were all happy on it. It was our last shift when we were going home in the morning. So it was always a good shift for that one.
Jeff talks to the control room operator he's relieving to familiarise himself with the day's business. There's nothing out of the ordinary to report. Ship ends. But on the production deck, work on the safety valve isn't finished. Replacing it will have to wait until morning. It's not a problem. The pump it's connected to is shut down. There are now 62 men running Piper Alpha on the night shift. The other 164 are off duty, eating, relaxing, or sleeping in their living quarters. Suddenly, an urgent alarm disrupts Jeff Bolland's routine shift.
It's an audible sound, which brings your attention to it. It will locate it then, on a visual basis, what's happened, and what we call the condensate pump in the ship.
Condensate is the oil man's term for LPG, liquefied petroleum gas, a volatile and highly flammable liquid. The pump compresses it to a pressure of 78 atmospheres. That's 45 times the pressure in a car tire. The pump has stopped working, but Jeff is still unfazed.
I've seen the condensate pump shrink that many times, I could tell you about 20, 30, 100, 200, and it was something that needed attention and something that wasn't a major problem. And the quicker you attended to it, the less of a problem it was.
Lead operator Bob Vernon goes down to the pump, 9 meters below the control room. It should be straightforward to restart it. But tonight, the production crew can't get it going. Piper Alpha continues to produce liquid condensate. There's now barely half an hour left before the storage tank fills up and the safety systems shut down the entire rig. This could lead to a complete loss of electrical power on the platform. Although not dangerous, it'll stop the rig producing oil, and the crew will go to almost any lengths to avoid this. They're feeling the pressure.
Things became more and more of a problem. So what started off as quite a routine incident, a minor problem, was snowballing.
Normally, a second pump would be available. But tonight, it's out of service for maintenance. If they can start that one, it should solve the problem. Vernon quickly checks the work permit and confirms that the scheduled maintenance hasn't yet begun. So that it can take over from the broken pump, the lead production operator signs this pump back into service. But then, at 9:55 p.m., a new problem complicates the situation further. An alarm sounds, warning Jeff Bollins of a small gas leak on the deck above the pump. He silences the alarm and informs another member of the crew, who's also down by the broken pump. The situation now escalates rapidly as Bollins receives several more alarms in quick succession, warning of further small gas leaks. These are followed by something more ominous.
They're just coming in one after the other. The next thing we do, we get high gas alarms, which is very rare, very serious.
It's 10 p.m. Captain Michael Clegg is aboard the maintenance ship Lowland Cavalier, stationed just 25 meters from the southwest leg of Piper Alpha.
That was the first section what I wanted to show for you. Did anyone write something on the paper?
Existing protection barrier.
Yes. What was it, for instance? Please, a little bit speak up, since...
They have safety layers, so process control layers, they have DCS.
They have DCS, yes. What else they have?
The alarm system, safety system.
For what? Alarm for what?
High pressure.
High pressure gas detectors. Yes, very good. What else? What was removed?
Safety valve.
Safety valve. And what did you? Shutting electrical power. Yes.
Emergency shutdown.
Okay, very good. So they have this one as well. They have procedure.
Work permit.
Permit over. Yes. That was, they talk about it, very good.
Logbook.
What?
Logbook.
Logbook, could be. We don't know exactly, we know exactly. You watch it. Yeah, I was in an opposite way, maybe that's the reason that I don't remember, but you can be right. Okay, so let's see what was the problem with it later on. The video will tell us, and we will a little bit analyze from deeper. I change a little bit here. I would like to move to somewhere here. I think that's okay. Sorry. Here I would like to move. Very good.
And he had witnessed a series of gas alarms that had come up just before the first explosion.
Before the first explosion, very important.
1 hour, 35 minutes to disaster. These gas alarms are all from the production deck. The investigators study the four 15 by 46 meter modules that make up this deck. They conclude that all of the alarms come from one area, module C. Another clue confirms this. Captain Michael Clegg on the nearby vessel Lowland Cavalier sees a blue flash coming out from the same area. These two pieces of evidence are enough to convince the investigators that Module C has to be the starting point for the disaster. But the flash of blue flame has to have a fuel source. What is it? Piper Alpha produces three highly flammable products: natural gas, liquefied petroleum gas, or LPG, known as condensate, and crude oil. All three are prime suspects for the start of the disaster. First, they investigate the platform's main product, crude oil. It burns in a very distinctive manner. Professor Dougal Drysdale is an expert in flame behavior.
Once you ignite it, the surface is burning. The flames have a characteristic appearance in that they will tend to be large and sooty.
But the initial explosion is not a large sooty flame. It's a blue flash. So Drysdale concludes it cannot be crude oil. That leaves natural gas and condensate.
Very good. It's a very important point, since right now we can see that what was the ignition source of the whole event. What was it?
Gas.
Condensate, call it, liquefied RPG. It's later on will be very important since, okay, this could happen somehow, but what's going to be further? Please be careful and watch it. Oh, let's see.
Was by a condensate release in the eastern end of the module. The only condensate at the eastern end of module C is contained in two safety valves. But these are safety devices designed to withstand more than twice normal operating pressures. How could they leak? Then the investigators make a vital discovery. One of these valves had been removed for a routine safety check. Could the open pipe be the source of the mysterious leak? They dig deeper and discover that in normal safety procedures, workers insert a flat metal disc to seal the hole where the valve has been removed, and that prevents any leaks. If the hole was sealed, condensate could not have come from there. But they remain convinced that the safety valve is the prime suspect. To check their theories, they conduct a series of tests on an identical metal disc, tightening its bolts by varying amounts. This video from the inquiry shows the actual tests. The test results show that the sealing disc could leak if workers tighten the bolts without a wrench, leaving them just finger tight.
As if the bolts were done fairly loosely, you would look done up and you'd look to there, but there was a gap.
This is a vital breakthrough. Investigators now believe that a leak from a loosely fitted metal disc is the starting point for the entire catastrophe. But there's a problem with this theory. The valve in question was undergoing maintenance. There should have been no condensate in that pipe. Solving this mystery becomes the new focus for the investigators. Using plans of the rig, they trace the pipe down to a different deck, where it connects to a pump. But they know this pump was out of service for maintenance. It should have had no condensate in it. Then they talk to the night shift workers. Their evidence reveals that another pump in service that night broke down 1 hour, 45 minutes before disaster. The lead operator perished, so they can't question him. However, the evidence suggests he intended to swap the pump in maintenance for the broken pump to keep production flowing. But the pump undergoing maintenance was missing its safety valve.
Because the lead operator was seen actually introducing condensate into this pump very shortly before the accident. There was not only the intent to start it, but there was also the opportunity.
Before starting up a new pump, workers must first fill it with a small amount of condensate. This happens 1 hour and 35 minutes before disaster. But this small amount of condensate leaks. The loosely fitted sealing disc, secured only hand tight, triggered the first gas alarm Jeff Bollins heard in the control room. When the pump was ready to start, the lead operator released more gas into it.
He opened up valves to introduce more condensate, and it was during this period that there was a very major release.
Up in the control room, this much larger leak triggered multiple gas alarms, including the high-level alarm that Jeff saw just before the first explosion. At 1 hour, 30 minutes to go, the leaked condensate explodes in Module C. Investigators are zeroing in on the chain of events, but there's a break in the link. Module C is protected by huge firewalls designed to resist intense flames for up to 6 hours. And this first explosion is not very violent. But photographic evidence reveals a surprise. Less than 10 seconds after Module C explodes, the picture shows a huge fireball ballooning out of the module next door, Module B. How did it break through the firewalls and spread so fast? The investigators carry out a series of computer simulations and experimental explosions, seen here. The results are surprising. While the firewalls are excellent at resisting fire, they can't handle explosions. Even a minor blast can tear them apart. The firewalls are made up of 2.5 by 1.5 meter fireproof panels bolted together. The first explosion breaks up the firewall, launching the panels around Module B like unguided missiles.
Each panel is equivalent to driving a one-ton car at 24 miles an hour into the pipework.
Investigators believe that these flying panels rupture a relatively lightweight condensate pipe in Module B. That condensate fueled the fireball seen in the photograph. But this fireball lasted only a few seconds. It may look big, but the investigators don't believe it was lethal enough to destroy Piper Alpha. Something else caused another massive explosion 19 minutes later that doomed the 20,000-ton platform. What was it? Investigators.
Let's see a little bit further. One more protection layer was here.
Firewall.
Which was it?
Firewall.
Firewall. Yes, very important.
A sequence of 20 photographs chronicles the early stages of the fire. It's not much, but it's the very best evidence they have.
You can see the fireball lifting away from the front of the platform, and that leaves behind a very different type of fire, producing a huge plume of smoke.
A smoky plume is characteristic of a crude oil fire. Module B was one of the worst places to have a fire, because it contains tanks that store up to 55 tons of crude oil. With 1 hour, 10 minutes left, the situation escalates. A colossal explosion shakes the rig. It creates an inferno that rages on the underside of the platform. But this new fire is not in Module B, where the first oil fire is burning. It's below it. How did it get down through the deck? Once again, investigators search for clues in the pictures taken just after the fireball.
If you look at the photographs, it's clear that there is a fire below Module B.
They realize this can only mean one thing. Flaming crude oil is running downwards to fuel this fire. They're certain that it drips onto an area where the rig's divers prepare for work. But this area is covered by grates. The burning oil should drip straight through the holes and into the sea. Instead, it settles there, forming a large fire. Again, investigators are stuck. Then they discover a vital clue. The divers have placed rubber matting over these gratings.
When they're diving, they didn't want to, with bare feet, step on very sharp grating. And unfortunately, above this area was a high-pressure connecting line to Tartan.
Tartan is another oil rig close to Piper Alpha. This pipeline carries high-pressure gas to it. Investigators now believe this oil forms a burning puddle on the rubber matting directly under the pipe, containing gas pressurized to more than 120 atmospheres, 70 times the pressure in a car tire. Without this rubber matting, the fire might have been contained, the whole catastrophe prevented. But with it, the pipe heats up quickly, weakening the metal. Intense heat, weak metal, high pressure gas, the next event is inevitable.
And when it burst, there was somewhere between 15 and 30 tons of high pressure gas ejected almost instantaneously. And that is what is seen in this huge fireball, 150 meters in diameter, completely engulfing the whole of the platform.
We will continue. One more protection layer somehow. What was it?
Metal disk.
Metal disk, okay. And one more additional, at almost at the very end.
The floor.
The floor. The design of the floor. It's not how to say just accidentally happened on this way. And later on we can see that they covered it and they just increased the fire, power of the fire. Okay, let's continue a little bit. We will be over soon. What else?
Great, photographic evidence is useless. So investigators gather electronic data from other oil rigs connected to Viper Alpha. 40 minutes to go. The investigators discover that the gas pressure in the larger of the two remaining pipelines begins to fall rapidly. It's this which is now burst. Only one gas line connecting Viper Alpha to the Claymore platform 35 kilometers away remains intact. 10 minutes remaining. There's another massive gas explosion. It's the final pipeline failing.
Just the last section.
Cleaning up the pieces. The deadly sequence begins at 9:45 p.m. when workers attempt to start a pump with a critical safety valve missing. What investigators don't understand is why the workers started the pump in this unsafe condition. The permit to work, or PTW, is designed to alert everyone to maintenance work that is underway to prevent just this kind of accident. When investigators analyze the PTWs, they discover that a permit was issued for routine maintenance on one of the pumps at 7:45 a.m. They believe that a separate permit was issued later on for work on its safety valve. But the permits that would prove this theory lie buried in the sunken remains of Piper Alpha, 145 meters beneath the surface of the sea. Then, 3 months after the accident, salvage teams raise two blocks of living quarters from the sea floor. 81 bodies are recovered and laid to rest. And the investigators are then able to hunt inside for further clues. They find a mass of waterlogged paperwork. Astonishingly, after a raging fire and 3 months at the bottom of the sea, this paperwork yields critical evidence.
And lo and behold, yes, there was a copy of the actual permit to work. And it was a huge buzz because we had heard that one was probably issued, but we weren't sure. And here it was, we actually had the actual copy.
This is the original permit, recovered from the bottom of the North Sea. Permit to work number 23434 for the maintenance operation on valve number PSV504, dated July the 6th, 1988. It's the first link in the deadly chain of events. Investigators are now certain that there were two permits issued, one for the pump and a completely separate one for its safety valve. On Piper Alpha, the crew stores permits in different boxes for each area of the platform. This seems logical, but creates a fundamental problem. Because the pump is in one part of the platform, but its valve is in a completely different area. And that means the permits are stored in separate boxes.
That really starts to be where the problem comes. The two permits should have been held together. But simple error, clerical mistake perhaps, meant that these two permits were separate.
When the operator checks the pump's permit, there's nothing with it to warn him that the safety valve has been removed. That permit is stored separately in another box. It might as well not have existed at all.
So when pump B stopped and there was a question asked, can I get pump A going? The maintenance liaison said, yeah, fine.
As they attempt to start the pump, they set in motion the chain of events. Investigators believe that the workers on duty that night did not know the safety valve was missing. Otherwise, the experienced operators would never have tried to start the pump. The only permit they see is for the pump. It doesn't mention the safety valve. At the heart of this tragedy, behind the raging fires.
Okay, that was the case. How many people died? 167 people died. How many altogether were on this station? 226, something like that. I've just wrote it here. I don't know where. 226, yes. Approximately 2 hours takes this disaster and totally ruined everything. When was the first explosion? Do you remember? Approximately 1.5 hours earlier than the whole disaster just finished. Which means that, regarding to the detailed investigation report, that, just a moment, I'm coming here. This is nothing, just look at this, not only me. The detailed investigation report says that maximum three people died after the initial explosion. It means that 164 people died, how to say, without any serious cause. So if we are prepared well, minimum, we have to be able to save them. What was still in the report? No one says anything to them over this rest of the 1.5 hour. It's just terrible. I believe so. Maybe you remember that there were two other platforms which was just connected to Piper Alpha, but they almost immediately lost the communication. Of course, 27 years back, no mobile phone, etc. issues, and I don't know, satellite phone, something like that. So it's very bad situation. No communication at all. One more very important issue to know, not from this video. Both of the other platforms keep ongoing operation and push the oil to the Piper Alpha over this rest of the 1.5 hour. Since I was lucky to attend fire brigade conferences, something like that. They are very good men. But we have to know, almost, in case of oil industry fire, when we will have supply for material, they are not able to kill the fire in many cases. So we really have to be aware of it, this information, which means that we can have very good emergency plan, fire brigade, etc. issues, if a lot of, how to say, supply crude or any other flammable materials just going into that place where the burning is exists already, they are not able to kill. It's very important. Okay, let's see a little bit systematically. Can you help me to go to the table? And just collect very quickly there. You can write here. Oh, sorry. Here we go. I hope you can reach this point. The safety layers, what we identified already. Please help him. What was it?
Alarm system.
Alarm system. Very good.
First procedure.
Try to separate a little bit. Alarm system from gas detection, and maybe alarm system from the unit otherwise. This video didn't touch exactly the other alarms. How does it work, or did it work exactly? Or what was the logic behind? But we don't know that we had alarms from the gas alarm. Okay, which was otherwise useless. Could say that finally. Okay, what else?
Working
permits. PTV, very good. Okay, what else?
Shutdown system.
ESD, could say that. Emergency shutdown system.
ESD.
Excellent. What else?
Shift transfer.
Handover, takeover procedure, okay. I'll just abbreviate.
Paperwork.
It's not really a paperwork, since it's mainly based on the verbal things. The logbook, it's a different story. We can write here the logbook, but the shift handover takeover procedure. They have it somehow. This is two separate things.
Okay, logbook. And
Shift handover takeover. Just write it there. Perfect. What else? What was removed?
Safety valve.
Safety valve. Yes, this will be this afternoon. Still is coming.
Safety valve. Okay.
DCS, very good. PSV, very good. DCS, I'm sure that it was. Don't forget, one protection layer was mentioned by Jolt. 10 minutes to intervene. Sometimes it's fair. Operator, yes. Operator. Human factor, something like that. Firewall. It was useless, but it was. Yes, the floor. Floor network, I don't know how does it call.
Grade.
Artem. Okay.
Metal disc.
Any other?
Metal disc
or blind disc, however we call it. Flange. Blind flange. This is part of somehow the design, I believe so. It should be. If you remove something, the mechanical integrity has to be kept on the technology. Okay, I think this is it. Before you sit down, please, try to identify what is the mitigation layers and what are here the preventive layers. Or you can just sit and please take over the pen for someone. Anyone? Right now, a lady, please. Except Cornelia in this case, but she's a lady as well. Very much. Please, Maya, don't think so much. Let's go. Please, try to identify them.
Which are the preventive and which are...
Yes.
This is preventive.
Definitely. You agree?
Yes.
Yes, we...
It's still preventive. Otherwise, we can... If we are going or we just attend the... HOSOP analysis, HOSOP LOPA SEAL analysis. This is the last protection layer. Why? Since if the PSV started to work, we consider that one that is put the material on a safe way to the flare. That's why we consider as part of the system. And of course, the probability of failure of demand is can be calculated. Otherwise, these are usually SEAL 1 value. Perfect?
Okay. Blind flange.
Yeah, could be the design part.
Floor.
Floor in this case.
Floor.
also on firewalls?
Firewall, it's a question. Not really. Since the firewall is something like dike, fire killing system, extinguish system. So it can be that part, which is just after the disaster start to work. Of course, in this case, the floor can be the question. Mm-hmm. Since before the disaster, it's nice to walk there, especially with boots, not without this one. So it can be part of this one. But we just handle like the part of the original design as well, since if it's not there, it's very dangerous to walk somehow there, if you can. Okay, let's see.
Human preventive.
It's preventive. Very good.
Shift handover, of course, preventive.
Yes.
Local also.
Yes.
ESD.
Emergency shutdown.
Very much preventive. This is currently in our units the most important preventive layer.
Working permit.
Preventive.
Preventive and alarms also.
Yes. Very good. Thank you so much, Maya.
Thank you. Very welcome. David, one important thing is missing.
I'm so sorry. Go ahead.
Just the emergency procedure is.
Was in place or not? I'm pretty sure that they have it.
But
yes. Very good. Something like this. This is?
Mitigation.
Who said that preventive? Otherwise, it's a mitigation. It should be. If as a result, let's come. As a result of when we are just designed this emergency procedure and we just see that something has to be changed in our procedure because of in case of emergency we cannot react well, of course it can be somehow in a quotation mark preventive as well. But as in itself, the document and what we have to follow in case of emergency is definitely the second version of it. Okay, one more additional information about the situation. The work permit. What was the issue with the work permit? That was two separate work permit without any link together. It's very important. Over the detailed investigation, they just analyzed that the two work permits were stored on a different places. So if the operator or the shift leader can be patient enough, he had not a chance to see it. The other one. Otherwise, he wasn't, looks like, from the investigation. We didn't have any issue here in this video with the maintenance guy. But we have to know from the detailed investigation that one of the maintenance guy, who was the leader otherwise, he was the first time as a leader. Why can be it is important? Since if you are a leader, team leader, you have to take the responsibility for your work. What was the real issue with them? Do you remember back? What they did wrong exactly?
They didn't fasten the light flange with this.
Very good.
But only by hand, and basically it looked okay, but
it's useless. It looks like it's okay, maybe worse than if it's not there. Not maybe, yeah. I'm sure that worse. It's very important. So always we have to be careful with it. That's why in the refineries where we are going out, doesn't matter, or any other facilities, onshore facilities, and if the blind flange is not there, never ever forget you are, how to say, only agency people, but you have to aware some of the knowledge 4-8 of the bolts has to be there and tight, always. And it has to be looks shine, something like that. If it's not, start to complain. Since that kind of disaster could come there as well. It's very important. Okay. The other issue with the human. From the detailed report, the human was very busy. Since we know that oil platform, a lot of oil is coming, maybe not right now, but we hope as a mole that in the UK we will have still chance to get a lot. But at that time they were very busy. We're going to have a break in 5-10 minutes, okay? In this case, they almost skipped the handover takeover procedure. They didn't were, how to say, aware what has happened. It was mentioned that there are no any serious issue. But we really know that, of course, especially from Cornelia presentation, that the critical equipment has to be identified, and we have to know that which equipment is critical and which not. Doesn't matter if a spare equipment is the spare parts, could say that, or a hot parts is existing or not. Doesn't matter, since if something will be failed, we're gonna be in trouble. That's happened here as well. What was the issue with this? Do you remember?
It was stated in the video that the maintenance personnel who removed the safety valve, even though they had planned to finish it or repair it until 6 o'clock, they didn't. They basically prolonged it for next day. I don't know there was anything anyway how communicate to anybody.
Yeah.
Basically, it has not been done, even though it was planned. So.
Otherwise, from the detailed investigation report, they just write on a permit to work and they put on back to the table. But they didn't communicate personally. That was a really big mistake. And otherwise, I'm not pretty sure that 27 years later, in our case, in each permit to work back situation is working on that way, that the contractor is coming. Okay, sir, I finished it. That I did it. And this is missing. Be careful. Later on, this will be very important for us. Don't forget this issue. Okay, what has happened? Later on, everyone was just relaxed and go up to the upstairs and have fun, something like that. The next shift start to operate. Of course, they recognize that there is a failure with this pump, the given one, which has to, I don't know, the condensate put to the other platform, something like that. That was mentioned at 78 bars, approximately. In the detailed investigation report, it's 100 bars, but doesn't matter. It's high. Could say that if it's something leakage there, immediately you can get gas anywhere. What they did? They get failed, one of the pump, you remember? And they just decided very quickly that, okay, put the operation the other one.
Even though it has been maintained.
Yes, but they were aware of it. They didn't know about the safety valve. They just said that, okay, we just open some valve, some of the close, and we can start. Right now, if we have lockout tagout procedure, is it possible? Which it could be the other protection layer? Hopefully not. Hopefully not. If we are good in it, of course not. But they didn't at that time. Okay, the first explosion happened. We are here. What has happened with the wall? Fire wall.
It collapsed.
Collapsed. But before the fire wall was collapsed, we got many alarms. You remember? Which is for me, who is working with process safety management and sometimes, how to say, not me personally, but over the Hazop Lopa SEAL studies, we just identify the design and logic, the system, ESD, how does it has to work. If I get serious alarm from somewhere, we immediately has to ignite the level 1 shutdown. Minimum of 2, to close everything in the system, but it's better to warm. It didn't happen exactly. Yeah. Everything was in operation, as you could see.
If
go ahead.
If they are receiving the gas from other platform, could they have to do it? Or the other platform should have
they always had held
down
emergency CDs.
That protection layer, we don't know about it. I think it's missing. AEV, it's called, emergency isolation valve. If I have serious problem with me, with my facility, immediately I would like to close out each of the dangerous materials from there, and the ESD has to be ignited this close, as a close. Important to know, they lost the electricity since they have electricity-driven fire water pumps in the unit. This is, we didn't list it here, but this is protection layer as well. Very important protection layer. They just lost it. They had diesel-driven fire water pumps. Why it is good?
They work with temperatures.
Yeah, definitely. But the case was, we didn't can realize from the video, that this was in a manual mode, not an automatic mode, which means that didn't start. Minimum on time, but I believe so forever. What was the issue? The leader of the whole unit decided, you remember the diving man who just put this, I don't know, rubber surface there? They had some maintenance under the rig. Under the platform, sorry, not under the rig, exactly, since the rig is in there. And they just switched off the manual mode, since in case of any emergency, when the electricity just fall out, the diesel pump just start, could start automatically, but the propeller of this pump, which is just pull up the water, was close to the, diving, yes. But it happened not that time, hours earlier, and they didn't put back. Yes. The other issue was with the platform, and they know about it 4 years long. They had the problem with the deluge system. The I don't know how does it call in English, which is just spread the water. Sprinkler. Yes, thank you. What was the problem? Very common problem. Normal steel pipe getting to be rusty, and the small parts just, how to say, plug the sprinkler. They know about it. They had a plan 4 years before to change it to the non-corrosive material, but they didn't. Okay, right now we stop, have a 5-10 minutes break, it depends on you, and continue. And after we are going to the structured way on the protection layers.
I have one question.
Go ahead.
They have a first alarm, gas alarm, first gas alarm. Why they didn't check this alarm, the first?
No chance to check.
Why?
Why? Since the operator just fall down, immediately get fire, and as you could see it in the video, within a minute.
They have some alarms, they decide to start pump again and again and again. In this case, they must stop the procedure, check the gas alarm. After that, they can decide to start pump again.
Not forced.
It's the main problem.
It's a wrong procedure.
Could be. Otherwise, you are right. Okay.
They check, and generally, no gas alarm.
Cause of problem of the gas alarm.
But the video says that, if you remember back, that they have one gas alarm, you are right. It's a very small one, but
after
maybe...
After 10 seconds or 20 seconds, they get several gas alarms.
Yes.
So they must decide, stop all, must be doing, check alarm, then after that you can...
If you remember back, sorry, just a minute. If you remember back short presentation, it was there, in case of emergency, every second decision of the operator is failed. This is a statistics. Doesn't matter that I am very clever and I don't know who and 30 years experience. I can get stressed and make a bad decision. That's why, usually, in hazoprofil analysis, we just almost keep the human factor. We try to put everything on the DCS, ESD system, sensors, etc. That's why. And the logic has to be that kind of. Usually, we do not wait 10 minutes for the operator reaction. It's very important otherwise. So your system does not wait for the operator. Of course, we calculated 10 minutes that, okay, he has a chance to do something. But the well-designed system does not wait for the operator so much. Okay, break.
Nelly. Sorry.
Maybe 5 hours.
It's not so much. Once I went to Spain, otherwise more time, that 28 hours drive. So 5 hours is just reasonably good. And you have a nice highway. Of course, be careful on the road. Okay. Anyone ready to continue? Almost, hope so. If not, doesn't matter, I will continue. Maybe some of you just watched this video very quickly. What protection layer it is in it?
Zero.
The design. It's very poor design, could say that, but this is the protection layer. Don't forget it. This is somewhere from Syria and recently. So it's not, 100 years before. Okay. I just quickly come here. We are here. 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 And I believe so here. Later on I will check it, but okay. We will close this case soon. But I would like to, encourage you to understand the real protection layers and what we can do. We cannot be blind. But later on I would like to show for you a message for agency people and for especially the leaders, the shift leader, not the shift leaders, line managers. What is their responsibility? One more thing is very important. Who likes to make audit? Not Audi, audit. Have you ever had a chance to make audit anywhere? Yes, most of you. What is the huge risk behind the audit? The huge.
That you don't reveal something and that will cause some incident or problem. And they will say that the audit took place, but it didn't find us a finding. And you can say it was just a sample check and stuff, but still it was an audit.
Very good. It happens many times in Piper Alpha. They had everyday audits regarding to the permit to work system. They have it. They had half year before this accident, the company audit, like we are doing the cross audit. They went there. One of the engineers says that, hey guys, this Darius system is not working properly. Please change it. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. This is the very big mistake. What we take it in this case. So if we are not good auditor, we are not believing that we are good in the topic, don't go and do not make any audit. Please. It's how to say right to me as well. It's very important. Here was approximately 3-4 years before one advisor from DuPont. He was a very clever guy, experienced, 7 times he was refinery manager, etc. And he told the audience, what I'm really like, auditing. Everyone was just saying, he's stupid, something like that. Maybe. But he answered why. Since if you do any audit, you have to be prepared from this topic. It's very important. Never ever missed to be prepared. That's the minimum. If you believe that you are smart enough, no way, sit down and prepare. Definitely. I'm pretty, how to say, hardly recommended something like that. It's very important. I believe so. The other important message, if I find it, it's coming from the guy who was the member of the investigation team. Just a minute. Not this one. I just try to find quickly. This is very short, but it's perfect.
All the divisions that I've talked about were the responsibility of management. So the first lesson is that safety is the responsibility of management. No one else. It's not the responsibility of the regulator or safety committees or anything like that. It is the responsibility of management. Management is a very wide term. Let's get more specific. It is the responsibility of line management. It is not the responsibility of the safety department. Safety department has a crucial role to play. It has things it must do. But it is not responsible for safety performance. That is the line management. And it is the line management from top to bottom, from the chief executive to the lowest supervisor. And in particular, the chief executive. He has to be totally committed and visibly committed. So that's the first lesson.
I think it was a clear message for everyone. If I will have a chance to, how to say, play this video to them, I will do it, trust me. Otherwise, some of our managers are excellent, some of our not so good in this. So that was the Piper Alpha case. I don't know if it's helpful for you for the future or not. I really hope yes, a little bit. So the takeaway message from this one, always consider all of your layer of protection, which is existing, which is required. We didn't touch so much the last one, but someone just wrote it. What should be required in the future? Any other protection layer? But I saw from there, for instance, AIV, proper ESD, LOTO, etc. issues. We deal with it, we have it, we have a knowledge regarding to this one. But it's very important to use it as well. And never ever forget, if you identify something which is just wrong, recommend it to manage to be better, don't waste your time. That's the message. Okay, back to our business somehow. Zsolt finished somewhere here. The nice part is over, could say that. I don't need this one, I need this one. PSV. Pressure relief valve, pressure safety valve, doesn't matter how we call it. This is the basic part of our technology. Can you imagine any oil industry technology without this one? I hope not. So this is the basic. This is the basic. Somehow, otherwise, in the recent, not the years, but in the recent months, we had failed with pressure relief valve. Do you know what is the result of it? Sometimes a disaster. Or just minimum serious incident. When we are talking about the overpressure control, we have the, could say that, system behind it, which is just started with the pressure relief valve, can be rupture disc, sometimes we use it. I didn't see, but maybe we can use it sometimes the relief stand pipes. This is the communication vessels, like the theory is working on that way. So there is the U-shaped pipe and there is water, not water, any liquid in it, which is just push back the pressure or keep the pressure. Later on we will see it in detail, of course. And if we are lucky, what is the end of this pressure relief valve pipe?
Decrease.
No, this is something equipment thing. Just think about it. Flare. Yes, this is the flare.
Blowdown system.
Blowdown system. Flare, doesn't matter how we call it. In many cases, it's really not true. Believe to be hope. In case of refineries, no PSV or any other rupture disk, which is just not connected to the flare. In case of upstream facilities, we have a lot, which is just still not connected to the flare. If the flare is in operation, be careful, since in Hungary, for instance, we have a lot flare, which is just only the chimney or the pipe, not in operation exactly. Let's see. What can cause the pressure? Very easy terms, I believe, so I don't want to waste so much time with it. Pressure, it can be what we're loading into the pressure vessels, of course, if the temperature is just going to up, or any kind of physical reaction, something like that, can cause the pressure in itself. Usually, otherwise, honestly to say that we are lucky, since we do not have so much incident with our pressurized system. What do you think, especially here in middle European region or European region, why?
Temperatures.
Not because of this term. Legal point of view, we have a lot of regulation and we try to keep it, or we have to keep it, and we try, of course, but we have to keep it. That's why we are reasonably good with these systems. This is, obligatory, a compliance issue to have it. It's important to know, of course, in some cases, and especially for the pressure relief valves, we just realized that that the time period of compulsory maintenance, not each of the cases are effective. So be careful with it. For instance, in Pakistan, maybe later on, but I don't know, we will have time for it or not, one of the pressure relief valves is failed. The unit was otherwise new, but the originally written maintenance procedure said that every 5 years we have to maintain this one. Later on from this presentation, we can see that what can happen with it over. 5 years is a long time, so don't trust in 5 years. Usually the practice to maintain it 1 year minimum. And of course, it depends on your, we will see it later on, original design, are we able to take out from the technology and maintain? We could see on a Piper Alpha they were, but somehow they didn't protect it against to start with this one. If you have any question, just stop me. Oops. I think it's here. Very simple picture. Pressurized system. Source of the pressure could be pump, compressor, etc., or chemical reaction, as we discussed. Pipeline, compensator, other assembly, etc., can be here, which is just like a pressure vessels. Pressure equipment, pressure vessels, safety valve, and finally the blowdown system or flare. Can be chimney, but we do not use for it. This is very easy triangle. Everyone use it, like it. Three of them has to be on a proper, condition and ready to act. If it's working, we can be survived. What is the main issue with this system? Of course, we have to sustainable operation, which is just a requirement for the pressure system. Each of the circumstances has to be keeping the control above it. This is important. Or we can get on that side, we control somehow with the stop the unit, something like that. Later on the rupture disk, by the rupture disk, we will see it. Since if the rupture disk start to work, you have to shut down and start it again, or minimum shutdown of the given part of the unit. And of course, bring the result. It's important. Oops. What can do the safety layer? It's very important. Of course, it's defend the consequence of the pressure. What's going to happen easily? Explosion. Minimum a fire, but most of them explosion. The whole system gonna be damaged in this case. Of course, it's defend the operator who are there, close to it. It's very important. And release the energy on the regulated way. I think it's very important, the regulated way. So we have to, or we can control this one. I don't want to read all of them. Later on, you can watch it from the presentation will be shared. And these are the regulation mainly behind. What can be wrong? How can the pressure goes up? Inlet is stable, but the outlet is closed. It's pretty easy. We just push the material into the vessels, but no takeover from it. These are really, how to say, easy term, which are just always used by the HAZOP study. What was the four things? What was mentioned by Zsolt? Yes. These are the four things what we watch in the HAZOP. In this case, mainly the pressure, the issue, which can cause, of course, the temperature as well. This is a further example, like heat exchanger, what can happen, the cold side temperature increase. Of course, in this case, this is not able to take over the thermal energy from the hot side, and somehow the pressure will go up easily. And if you think, especially in refinery case, reactors, if something wrong with the heat, too much heat, something wrong with the cooling water, etc. issues, the pressure can go up. Further example are mentioned here. You see, reflux loss, utility system, failure of control system, very important, could be, and I don't want to read all of them. It's very important, don't forget, but we can design in a different way as well. Each of the equipment required pressure control where the pressure can goes up. But if you are a designer, you can take on that way that you are looking on a system. So you don't have to put pressure relief valve, each of the pipe section, each of the equipment, etc. You can handle like a system. But you have to make sure that later on we will see it as well, that on the given place where you put this PSV, the pressure has to be present. So it cannot be on a dead leg part or something like that, where is the pressure is not present and the other part of the system, which is just huge, can be blown up. There are some aspects, how can we select this pressure safety valve. Since we will see it, there are many types of it. Important characteristic of pressurized. Properties of medium, why it could be important. Properties of medium. For instance, just one case. If something, go ahead.
Maybe if the depends on the boiling point, so if there is more vapor somewhere in the vessel, then pressure can
be. But in this case, I would say that usually with the parallel cascading system is working better. So use different type of PSV for it. If you have different materials with different boiling points, etc. issues. In this case, the property medium, much more the corrosivity, for instance. If it's something corrosive, you cannot use the easy carbon metal type of pressure relief valve. Or you cannot use the pressure relief valve, you have to use the rupture disc, for instance. Or first rupture disc and later on pressure relief valves to keep the pressure relief valve just, how to say, far away from the corrosive materials. Of course, in case of it start to work, it has to touch. But maybe 3 years long, it's going to be touched and totally corrosive, corroded. So that's why. Or other properties could be the temperature of the materials, if it's going to be freezing, or it can liquid means that water in there, just the water goes in and over the winter just frozen, you can lose your pressure safety valve. You believe that I have it, but you don't have. Blow off capacity. It's happened 4 years before, close to Szeged. One of our otherwise small gathering unit, there was a separator and we had a problem. And finally, after otherwise all of the materials went out on the quotation mark flare, that was only the chimney. But we were really lucky, since the pressure relief valve was half capacity when was required. And thanks for God, the whole system was for higher pressure than it was exist. But finally, we just realized that was where we can use PSV. What does mean relatively big idle time? First of all, where we use PSV? We use PSV as well there, where we need to continuous operation. Since the PSV is able to open, we say pop up and close back and continue everything like before, if we are lucky. I will tell the example for you later on. But it takes time to open, which is for us is very, how to say, quick, but process point of view can be just slow. So if the idle time, it has to be low, we use rupture disc. In this case, not PSV, usually, in general. Important message. That's why our PSV has to be connected somehow to the flare system, or the closed system could say that. Minimum a knockout drum, something like that. Later on we will talk about what does mean. Since the leakage can be anytime, anyhow, on the pressure relief valve. And if I can see so many people who are from environmental point of view, if we just continuously release to the air, maybe we cannot see, but we can measure somehow, this is not good. But the pressure relief valve do this continuously. Not continuously, not so big amount of it, but it is doing. Okay. Very good. And this is the opposite way, as you could see it, where the sudden, very quick pressure release is not allowed. Do not use their PSV. Where did not expected medium explosion. Okay, good. Let's go further. Why could be important for HSC people this one? Of course, I don't want to say that right now, tomorrow, let's go out to the refineries and check all of the PSVs, but the basic knowledge has to be in our pocket. This is the same like a lifting issue. Week before, one crane just fell down in Duffy refinery again. And it's a lot of arguing that the HSC people are not able to do anything. It's true. If I'm not know exactly how does it work, the lifting procedure, what are the basic rules, what I have to check, I have to understand, I'm not able to do this. The same issue with the pressure relief valve. I just experience in some cases that the people cannot, how to say, imagine in front of them, this is the pressure relief valve somehow. It looks always a different way, so be careful with it. So that's why we need the basic knowledge minimum. And we have to know what are the important factors we have to just watch it, especially if we are dealing with process safety management. Of course, if we are talking about the workplace safety, etc. issues, just forget the PSVs, don't go too close. That's the rule. Always has to be as close as possible to the defend equipment. So many cases you can see it, there is a pressure vessels and on the top there is the PSV. This is the best. This is the best. If you put somewhere there, like in our Piper Alpha case, you remember, it was mentioned that that was in a separate place. Maybe not in still in a section C, as we remember, but means that a separate section and one for level, one level upper or down, I don't know where it was, but not directly there where we can just, how to say, waiting for it exactly. And if it is there, or if it is not there, but the place is there where it has to be, of course I immediately, before I start the pump, I see that, guys, something wrong, it's missing. So that's the other reason otherwise. It was mentioned already. Do not put into the deadlock section, etc. So the flow has to be continuously. The pressure has to be touched, if it is any. It's important. Looks like on this way, here is the pressure vessels, and here is the pipe to the PSV. It has to be go up. If it's just going down, lot of condensate, etc. issues, just put into the pipe and getting to be corroded. So easily to say the highest point has to be there. Pipeline diameter and length has to be determined in a manner that pressure drop cannot be higher than 3%. Why it is important? Since if I use a 100 meter high long pipeline system, and finally at the end the pressure is only 5 bars, but the original one is 100, where the PSV has to start to work, it's never ever won't work before I lose my vessels. This can be the issue later on, why we are just investigation some action, like in Pakistan we did. What's the real pressure which reach the knockout drum after the PSV started to work? It will be a big issue otherwise. Is still high otherwise, since I will tell you later on that what we experienced. Okay. This is important issue. In case of any freezing material, if it can be, the pressure vessel system has to be heated. Heated, and if it's necessary, isolated. But there is one very important rule, which is just good for us to check it. Never ever isolate in itself the PSV. This is important. So if I just went to Russia and I saw some PSV which was just isolated, and I immediately asked them, "Hi guys, what are you doing?" And they corrected later on, of course. This is important. Okay. What's going to happen if you would like to, many cases you will see it, not only single PSV in building a system, usually we build it in parallel way. It was mentioned otherwise already that case of high temperature, maybe strongly, yes, that's what I wanted to touch in this case, never ever had the chance to close out the PSV. This can be the issue. Right now we do not have enough time, but in, for instance, in Russia, they made the chain equipment, something like that, which was just used for like this diverting valve. If they just close out one of the PSV, the other was open because of the chain driven the other valve, which is just was closed, the other one is open. It. Yes, it's happened. Up till then, the chain was broke down or just fall down. And anymore, anyhow, didn't work this system. So we can lose or we can just close out each of the pressure relief valve. And maybe we do not know about it, since there was no sign which is just open or closed, standing of the small manual wheel. So we can lose it. Here is the parallel installation of the PSVs. First issue, if the capacity is not enough, pretty clear, you have minimum two or maybe more. Otherwise, it's usually suggested not to use a huge one, some more smaller is more safe. Since, as I mentioned for you, these are mainly working on seal one level. What does mean seal one level?
1% basically that it will not work when it
Yes, should. 100 times to work, one is gonna be failed, minimum. This is the statistics behind. Maybe it will work 1,000 times, but maybe at the very beginning, the first time it's gonna has to be work, it won't. It's happened in Pakistan otherwise. Right now it's under investigation that valve, pressure relief valve design, was proper for the current operation or not. Since that was something new otherwise, not the regular one. They wanted to design or just figure out something brand new. But sometimes, I don't want to say that be traditional, but which is just worked already, use that one. It's a knowledge. Here is the cascaded issue. If you have to, leave out the pressure from the vessels, but like the organ pipe, you know, there are smaller and bigger ones, it could be happen with the PSVs as well. It says what I just, or written here what I just said. This is our case. In many times, we need a backup to maintain. Why we need it?
We just saw it in the Piper Alpha. If they had put in the pressure relief valve, replaced the one which had to be maintained with a separate one, and installed it, probably this wouldn't happen.
Oh, be careful, this is the difference, sorry, but I would support this idea, it's very good. If I have a spare one, the same type, just remove it and put it back immediately.
If you're not following the, let's say, prescribed time frame, which you are...
In this case, you have to do this.
You extend it, okay, then just replace it.
So in this case, what question you can raise? Any facilities? If you see the place where the PSV is not there, you have to strongly recommend them. Yes, keep the spare and just put it immediately there on the place. It's an important message. That's why I told you that I will learn from you as well. In our case, the refineries is working 4 years time, years shutdown period, approximately, isn't it? Maybe not in Sisak, sorry. Yes, Sisak is, you have a lot of chance to change it. Every week you can do it. In Sisak refinery, but those refineries like Riacom, which is just working continuously, you do not have any chance to just take from the continuous operation the pressure relief valve. This is just important. Okay. Skip it. You will read it. This is the pressure relief valve, the traditional one. Right now I tried to show you it's better to reach it quickly. I hope it will work. No, I believe so. I'm just a minute, not this one. This one will be. Yes.
Okay, folks, what we have here is a cutaway of a standard safety relief valve. First, I'd like to show you the parts. As you can see, this orange piece right here all the way up that threads into the body is the nozzle. That has one half of your seating surface. Here, as I is a ring, which helps control your blowdown. This gray piece here, correctly, is called the disc holder. The disc, which is inside of there, is your second half of your seating surface. It makes contact with the top of the nozzle, and that's what seals. The green piece here is a standard guide. There's a gasket. These yellow, two yellow portions right here are referred to as spring steps. The red, you can see the coiled spring. The screw portion right in here is called your compression screw. That is what will set the spring tension, which will control the set point of this valve. The light bluish color here is a lock nut. Once you have it set, this lock nut will hold the spring, the compression screw in place. In a relief valve, in the system, what happens is pressure comes in up into the nozzle and builds up. Once the pressure in the system exceeds the spring pressure, this valve will lift and it will come out the discharge port, allowing pressure to relieve itself and then reseat once pressure is back to normal. Some of the things you must always realize about a relief valve. The inlet, which is referred to where the pressure comes in through the nozzle, will always be smaller than the outlet discharge. That is so the pressure can bleed off faster, controlling the problem, and reseat. The ring, as I spoke to, we'll get into more, helps set a surface area to allow how much and how fast the discharge will go. Other than that, the main portions are the body of the valve, the bottom of the valve, and the cap. I did not talk about it because it's very difficult to see, but you have your spindle, and in a normal valve, that would be the stem. But in a relief valve, it's called a spindle. Some of the main things to realize about the spindle is there is a bearing surface on the spindle which matches up with the lower spring washer. The top washer has a bearing surface which matches up with the bearing surface of the compression screw. It is a good practice to always gray those in to know that you have good contact. And basically that's all there really is to a relief valve.
Okay. So this is the pressure relief valve in the reality. Could say that. Let's go back to the presentation. Do you remember the BP Texas refinery case? Don't say no. 2005, 31 deaths, etc. issues. In the video, there is, I'm just watching my notebook, but I didn't note my for myself the exact date, so I don't want to waste the time. But it is mentioned the pressure relief valve three this way. My children just show always this one, but it's not working for me. Three pressure relief valves were not open. They did it manually. The operator did it manually, before the explosion, of course. Just check back the video. So, which means that three of them didn't work. I don't know how many years long, were just there without any maintenance. I can just imagine. Okay, there are many types of it. I'm just trying to show for you quickly, but later on you can check back if you are interested in into the presentation. There is a mechanical load, PSV. Of course, here is the spring and the weight and how to say weight with the balance, something like that. This is working, how to say the working function in this case, the same, could say that, the mechanical load, but the pressure on the pressure relief valve is coming from the different reason or spring, etc. issues. We do not use it exactly, but in some cases maybe, but not really often in refineries, pneumatic and hydraulic. Hydraulic system otherwise can be confusing, since you really cannot imagine that this is the safety valve. Me as well, I'm just Googled it and then find it. So, but if we have this one, it looks on this way. It could be the common issue. Otherwise, usually we have connected with flange. You can see here the flange easily. Be careful. Each of the bolts has to be there and do not keep the short bolting. This is the other issue. On last Friday, we were in a stop car day in Song, and one big separator was under construction or almost before the PSSR, which is just started. I went up there and I saw the PSV with short bolting. And I told the gentleman, hey guys, right now this is the time to be aware to manage it well. They were just surprised, okay, we will do it. I don't know they did it or not. I will check back later on, but it's important, could be. Since this is part of, very important, part of the pressure system, pressurized system. Oh, the other one, just connect it with the thread. You can see it. Usually we do not use it, but you can find maybe. Here we are, rupture disc. Do you have any experience with rupture disc in the real operation?
We have in refinery.
Yes.
In some position, we have some rupture disc.
Okay, let's see. What is it and how can we use system from overpressurized or potentially damaging vacuum condition? It's important. It can work opposite way. Which can you imagine? Which vacuum condition can you imagine? Very easily.
For example, if you have a vessel with hot fluid, and if that fluid cool down during the night or something else, there will be vacuum in the vessel.
Can be. The guy from the refinery, I'm pretty sure. Guy from logistic, do you remember Soyol? 15 years before, they just, demolished this tank, approximately 15, 20 years before back. They just suck out the material from the big 20,000 cubic meter tank, but the the venting system was just out of function, could say that. And they just, suck in the big tank. They were lucky, nothing has happened. Of course, it's a lot of money. And they figure out very quickly that, okay, we don't need, and we wanted to otherwise demolish this tank. And they did it immediately, almost. This is important. The last one as well, not really for us, but the cost. But why we do not use it? It was mentioned otherwise. Why we do not use it? In many cases. Since if it starts to operate, this is the first and last time to use it. So we have to stop minimum the special section of the unit and just change it immediately. I really do not want to go to the detail, otherwise I can really not pronounce. I just Googled it and I do not have any idea, but reposer, which is just means just open it like the rose, something like that. You know it, tipping over, which is just on this way, the pressure is come from here and somehow just open it. And the braking disc, very easy, just like the brake window glasses on the car. And here is the perforated, I think on this way, just somehow perforated and go away. And this is, which is just interesting, I think it's here, can be melted. There are special material under pressure can be melted. Oops. It could be an interesting, sorry, which is just indirectly working. I never ever experienced this one, but maybe somewhere we have it. Brusting, something which is just ignite a small explosion and just that's open the disc immediately. And the other one use the knife, piston knife, it's called it. I never ever see in the reality, but good to know it can be. So it says that only for one use. It's very important. Ideal time is mentioned here, as we discussed. This is started to work almost immediately. This can be in some reaction or somehow important. No waste of time. No leakage through to the rupture disc is important. Not like in the PSV, pressure relief valve. And it's important. Deposit, freeze, etc. issues. Especially from the pressure relief valve, it really can touch it. Just imagine that some of the material just sticking on there and almost close the way. Of course, it can happen if it's, how to say, a little bit far from the defended equipment, here in this case, if the pipe gonna be plugged. Always we have to be very careful, otherwise not just in this case, since in the Pakistani case with the knockout drum, we had the same, but it was not with the pressure relief valve. The measuring equipment, the measure pipe was tugged with sludge. We didn't realize it. We believe that each of the data which is just show for us, it's proper. It wasn't, since the liquid didn't go over. Of course, the pressure relief valve, how to say, the pressure are higher in this case, so it can go over maybe much easier, but you never know. Influence factor, opening pressure, which can make a difference, could say that, regarding to the original design. One of its is very important, corrosion. Can be really dangerous or not? Exactly otherwise if you think, you can lose your profit, something like that. But if it's open earlier than it's required, we could say that it's okay. But in some cases not. Since in Pakistan, it's happened that the PSV pop up much earlier than it was required. Otherwise, this pop up wasn't, how to say, stopped. It's keep it open. And all of the liquid, that was the in the liquid phase, the PSV, it's somehow a little bit wrong. So the original design failed. Push all of the material into the knockout drum. You can imagine. So you lost your first protection layer, which was really not, how to say, just imagine that it could happen or not. So in this case can be the problem. Be careful with it, since the operator didn't expect it, that something wrong with the PSV. They believe that something wrong with the lever flow controller or the flow indicator. They believe that it's wrong, since they just closed behind it the regulator. So almost the whole flow was just closed out, but still the flow is just going. The flow indicators show for them, but they didn't expect regarding to the pressure level that something can be wrong. And all of the material went to the knockout drum. And later on, there were some other potential layer which just missing behind. In this case, it's important operation temperature, which has to be designed. We have to keep it. In some cases, we have, of course, in the refineries technology card, we are happy with it, and we try to follow them and control them. This is just a very good way otherwise. But in case of many other operation, I just experienced many times, the operator just somehow manage the values. Of course, they don't want to allow to the, how to say, the LOPC event. They don't want to allow this. But between them, they're just playing with the conditions, could say that. It can be dangerous, not only for the rupture disk, it can be dangerous for the other technology as well. Mm-hmm. Relation between the operator pressure and opening pressure. This is interesting. It cannot be. It's better to define how to say. I don't know exactly. This is the standard. Which pressure can be inside and which pressure can be open the rupture disk. Of course, has to be not a significant, but it has to be a distance between two of them. This is important.
Until three bars, there is half bar distance between.
You know the standard.
Yes, 3 to 60 bars, it is 15%, and above 60 bars, it is 10% or.
Very good. We have a lexicon here, big lexicon. Okay, thank you so much. Let's go further. This is, I hope so, just only one slide. I never ever seen, only in a school, otherwise I just remember back, this kind of U-shaped pressure standpipe communication vessels, call it. Have you ever experienced in our operation? I don't think so. Here we are, flare. The flare is the very end of our safe system, could say that. Have you any experience with flare? Have you ever on the top of it, something like that? No? I was lucky. This is me up there. In Kurdistan, you can imagine, 48 degrees outside, sunny weather, something like that, but I went up there, 64 meter high. Survived. Once you have to try, but it wasn't in operation, that was the PSSR otherwise. So we just fill out the checklist, and I wanted to see on a tip as well, before I just check it or click it. This is important. Let's see very quickly the flares and the main parts of it. Two major reasons that we have it. Prevent from the possible fire or explosion, very important, I believe so, and the environmental pollution. Recently, do you remember Anya was here, Anya Flego? She's my colleague, and she's dealing with the environmental issues. And right now, not just in ENP, be careful, something European regulation is coming, and if I'm not wrong, 2020 or 35, I don't remember exactly the date, it's far away from me still. No flaring anymore. You can imagine. Right now I can't. Maybe someone can. But that's gonna be a big issue for us. So be careful. I don't know, maybe someone is just well prepared this kind of new regulation standard, etc. issues, but it will coming. But currently, we have to learn how does it work, the flare, trust me. I think after this period of time as well. But let's see. What we have to manage with the flare, which is just very important here. Heat, smoke, light, noise. What is exactly the flare? This is a picture of your unit, something like that. Since all of the easy people who are just not working here exactly, but working in maybe Sasolomba, the Tufi refinery, or Rijeka somewhere, they just only things are watching the flare. If the flame is big, oh, something wrong. Come on, they are stupid and kill the environment and etc. issues. This is with my boss advice. We went to Audio. He went to crazy immediately since we saw flaring. They were lucky otherwise, since the other department just put the material on the flare, so not the manager of the EMP. But it was a hard time for him that we started to ask that what the heck is going on and etc. issues. And he started to call everyone. So this is the flare, it's a picture of your unit. If something big, it means that any problem, not good, yes, easily to say that. So that's why later on I will show for you the example that what kind of flare we can use it otherwise. It's expensive and a lot of area is needed for it, that do not be visible for outside. This is a future question of our refineries, which is just a very sensitive question. Be careful, since it was mentioned by Zsolt. Zsolt is not here right now. The reputation. This is flaring issue, somehow the reputation as well. The noise, if your refinery is close to the inhabited area, I'm just thinking CSOC is not so wrong. Of course, you are not so much operation right now, so not so much noise for the environment. Bratislava, I'm pretty sure that Bratislava refinery, the flare issue can be the issue, definitely. And Rijeka as well. Since
Heat plant in Nivea also is near the...
Very good. That's the point. I'm just thinking about the other side where I was. Yeah, maybe the Ivanichgrad and more than not so exactly.
The past of more the exactly. There was Mantova, which was it's a serious issue.
Yes, you are right. That's why we close it.
Yeah.
Over this presentation is true, but otherwise not. Okay. What about the flare system as a system? I try to be quick since 5 minutes left, maybe. Could say that. It was mentioned today, knockout drum. What is it? Exactly, this is a separator. Easy? It has to be big enough. Enough capacity. And be careful, not follow the Pakistani case, what they did. They push here intendedly not only the vapor, they pushed here the liquid as well. They just designed as a big one, and they believe that they can keep it safe. It was said that 35% of the limit, two pump will start and suck out the liquid from the knockout drum. It didn't happen otherwise. We do not have enough time to go into the details. Usually this separator used only for what?
Yes.
Very important. Of course, liquid is coming. That's why we call it separator. And we try to separate, or we manage the separation from the gas, the liquid. That's why we have usually pump here, and we just pump out if it's any. Flare header. This is the flare stack. Could say that here is the liquid seal. Later on, I have a slide for it. Molecular seal. It's very important. In EMP, we do not have it, I believe so. We have it, Maya? No, I didn't see on this flare. Exactly. And this is the pilots and steam or air assist. This is a general picture about the flare and the flare tip, never ever forget. Okay. This is the liquid block. Somehow here. It depends on the design, how does it look like. Very easily, you put through the liquid your gas, and if it's sunny, the liquid hydrocarbon part can be just pulled out or separate from the system. Later on, you can check it. This is the liquid block of in the flare stack. It's working on this way. Sorry, I'm a little bit rushed since our time is over. And I'm pretty sure that you would like to go home today. Molecular seal, this is just very important. What is important for us from cost and environmental point of view, if our molecular seal working properly, 10 times less purge gas is needed for our operation. Why we use steam or purge gas in flare?
Prevent smoke,
but the steam can cause noise otherwise, but against the smoke is steam is just perfect. And the purge gas, we have to keep the condition of the continuous burning, so you cannot lose your burn anyhow. I don't know how to say in English, but you have to somehow intensify your fire. Keep it always burning all of the part which is just coming to the flare. It's very easily to say that I think
it is. Some poisonous gases, for example, hydrogen sulfide, you have to burn it.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Otherwise, in our case, in Duffy refinery, we use a separate flare from this kind of materials. So if you are a little bit, how to say, more advanced, you keep separate different type of materials, different flares. From different materials, you prepare the flare, I believe so, and you just keep in a different condition, which is just very important. Am I right? Almost in the frame. Okay, knockout drum. It can be designed in a different way, otherwise we do not like this one, like the storage tank type of it, since there are a lot of problem. What was here just a minute in our problem? You see this? We had on this way the level measurement. We just take over the liquid from the bottom. In the bottom, that kind of tank always get any sludge, dirty things, could say that easily, and it's plugged. Our measurement pipe. And in our measurement pipe, there is just only one. We have two, high alarm and high alarm. Yes, but it was Zsolt mentioned the common cause flarer, which means that if it not touch the liquid, the first one and the second one as well, of course in this case, they were not able to give us any alarm. And we believe that everything go right, but just the level just rise and rise. And later on the top of the measurement pipe, just came immediately back to the liquid and stopped the whole unit immediately. Just very quickly finalized the story. The ESD started to work, but this was just only the ESD 2 level shutdown. Since if the sun is coming from here, your separator knockout drum is almost full, or more than a high level, you couldn't get any gas in. We get it regarding to the original design, and we get the very quick, the whole liquid was just kicked out from the knockout drum, and the flare stack was attacked. Approximately 1 meter amplitude was, or diameter, doesn't matter, just moving the flare pipe, you can imagine, and all of the basement boards was just ruptured. We were extremely lucky that we didn't lost exactly the flare, since the rope just still hold it. Okay, just very quick, flare tips at home. This is the homework, you can watch it in detail. There are many nice pictures about it, not in my presentation. Flare types, this is the ground flare, call it. These are not so high, or we just make a lot of small one. Flame not visible, This is the first one. Of course, we can see from inside the flange, but from outside it's not visible. Without steam at, no smoke, it can be important. Less noise. Required more place and more expensive. So we do not follow this one usually. Be honest. These are the typical flares, what we can see. In the Duffy refinery, you can see this one. Derrick supported, could say that. And there are some which is just guide supported, which is just standing alone. I don't know. This is very expensive. Otherwise, since the structure has to be strong. I don't remember this one. Oops, sorry. This is just for interesting, since we are talking about Piper Alpha. Honestly, I tell you, maybe 5-10 years before, I always believed that, hey guys, they have a nice crane. No, these are usually the flare. Not usually, these are the flare. You can see different type of structure of it. This is me, not important. This is very important, and we finish. The safety is not an intellectual work, not something to keep safety department in work. Never ever forget. The reason to go conferences or presentation, not right now, we are here. Safety is truly a matter of life or death. So, never ever forget. When you're going back and do your work, if you are doing well, we won't know it, but we can avoid the accident. But if you do something wrong or do nothing, we will see the result soon in the agency info or the future developed ENABLOM program. Thank you so much for your attention. Have a safe trip to home. I hope you partially minimum enjoyed this training. And please keep in mind that safety is truly matter of life or death. Thank you. Have a great afternoon. Oh, thank you.